Has anyone actually noticed that your Bucks beard keeps actually really fucking growing? He's a pitcher, possibly because of all the steroids that he's been absorbing, that his beard just keeps growing and growing and growing. There's gotta be something beyond that fucking beard, because he can't just keep growing like that in such a short amount of time. I mean, Kubo's gotta fucking notice that. But fuck, let's get on with the review, yeah? Now, this chapter was a lot better than last week's chapter, I felt. And I'm not so much as hype, but I'm more of the questions. I've got a lot of questions to ask, which I hope will be brought on later on down the road, because I felt like this wasn't really a setup chapter. It was one of them chapters which made you kind of go, like, why is that happening like that? I'm not quite sure what this chapter was. I don't think it was a setup, and I don't believe it was a progression chapter either. I felt like it's just kind of there, but it's relevant. I was really impressed by the reactions that Basby and Lilato Lampard actually gave in this chapter. I truly felt in this chapter, like, that through the character designs, through how they were looking, through the emotion that they were bringing, I truly felt that they were despising New Watch for what he was doing to him. And I generally felt a sense of pain. And to do that through manga is very hard thing to do. So I was very impressed by the fact that Kubo was able to bring out that emotion and make us, the viewer, or me, the viewer, be able to feel that. And as well, it also plays to the part where Ruki and Renji are kind of just looking, going, what the fuck is actually going on here? And it's always nice to see Ruki as well. I always miss that face of hers. And I'm actually starting to really like Lilato as a character, actually. Out of all the kids like Stone Rutters, I didn't think I'd start to like Lilato, because she's a Stone Rutter with some kind of sense, some kind of moral to her. I mean, she got rid of Pepe, for one, which is, like, fair play, because that must have been disgusting. As you've said, that was fucking disgusting. Yet she kind of knows somewhat what's right and wrong. And again, her emotion with Basby saying, you know, we're not dying in a fucking place like this, just really, you know, it really grabbed out to me, grabbed out to my attention. So I was really pleased by that. We see Byakuya in out of this chapter. Seems like he's finished his opponents. He's just wandering, looking for more, I'm guessing. Now, here's the thing that's, like, kind of grinding my gears a bit. Kyoriku's in the squad, one barracks, right? What the fuck is he doing chilling in the captain commander's barracks when there's a fucking war going outside? What is he doing chilling? What is he doing as of relevancy? Just sitting there doing nothing. Because that's all I'm seeing. All I'm seeing is him just chilling and observing what's going on from squad one barracks. Like, that's what concerns me the most, and that's what pisses me off the most, is that he's just chilling there. And then the fact that he can sense that, you know, squad zero is in fucking danger, and the fact that he's posing to want to say, okay, let's fucking go up there. Mate, you've done nothing for the second half of the war, but just apparently staying in them fucking barracks. What are you doing? Don't get me wrong, Kyoriku's strong. We know he's strong. Fitting one of the top espadas with just the Shikai, obviously he had some help, but he still held off on his own without using Bankai. And of course, everybody wants to see that Bankai, as well as Ukitake's, which is best here as well. What the fuck's he doing? No, it just feels like Ukitake, just stop. Sort out the shit in the Seros here first before you start concerning yourself about Squad Zero. And last time I remembered, it's not that fucking easy to get up there too. Now let's actually talk about Squad Zero, because this is where it kind of piques my interest on questioning. We've got X-Axis here shooting, and I'm not allowed to say bullets because he said they're not bullets. Just says wherever his gun is aimed at, pierces whatever is in its way. So we can suggest that maybe it's a bullet, maybe it's a compression of Reishi just fucking, I don't even know. Basically, all we know is that he points and it does something. That's why I can kind of understand from a viewer's perspective saying, okay, Namaya wouldn't be able to block an attack that he can't see or can't really sense or predict where it's going to be. The only way he can predict it is seeing where that gun is pointing and moving out the way. Which, as a review, is pretty sad, because I'm supposed to look into this. I'm supposed to try and guess what this fucking is. I simply can't. This thing is going through fucking Kurenji and Fat Bitch's weapons. And the only thing we got out of this is that X-Axis said, okay, look, this isn't a new power, this isn't a power-up or anything, this was just power that I've always had inside me that I haven't been able to bring out. Basically, you are Barkers, been able to unlock their potential. That's why they are the special guards of Jewel Bark, because of what they can do. And this proves it. Now, the other question is, does this make Squad Zero exposed? I want to say no, simply for the fact of, you were prepared, did the job right at the first bit. Jua Buck is a powerful being, and when he uses one of his powers to help out his comrades and the unexpected happens, you can't defend yourself against the unexpected. So don't get me wrong, Squad Zero is fucking powerful as fuck. Unfortunately, they don't have the data or they don't know what is going on to defend or fight against their opponents. Of course, Nehemiah, shoulders fucked. And he's got like a hole right through the chest. Is this it for Nehemiah? I feel like Squad Zero does have something in the works. Like, either that bitch has got some food to give him, or generally heal him, or Karinji can replace his blood. A really tricky ball game since they've got four enemies right there. But this also leaves the question as well, where's Shinjimaru? What's she doing throughout all this? I'm hoping she's in the background and she's kind of observing and analysing what is going on. Hopefully so she can find a way to kind of counteract all this. I gotta give Nehemiah props, he's still fucking standing after like two shots, man. That compulsory dude, the one with the hood up, still not quite sure what his power is, but he looks like he's fucked up that kind of birdcage that bitch made. And we end this all off with Jibei versus Jubak. Jubak comes in, makes his appearance, tells him to move out of the way, saying his name, says, don't call me by my name, otherwise, basically, you ain't gonna be talking again. You know, we potentially know the outcome. We know Jubak's powerful as fuck, and we know he's gonna potentially, he is gonna get through Ichibei, let's be honest. But Ichibei is a strong motherfucker. There is a lot of mysteriousness about him. I actually really can't wait to see what Ichibei has to offer if he can damage Jubak before he goes up against the Soul King, or what he's gonna do to kind of deflect Jubak from getting through the other side. Generally kind of excited to see what Ichibei can do, because we know this guy, not a guy to fuck with. I want to see what this whole mysterious kind of characteristic this guy has got. I want to see why he would be the top member of Squad Zero, why he is the face of Squad Zero. So I'm excited to see where that's going. It was more of a continuation of the fight that we got. It was a very enjoyable chapter, and I am interested to see what has been set up for us. Is Nemaiwetsu gonna die? I really hope not. I love Wetsu. Ichibei versus Jubak. Of course, we're not going to get that for a few chapters. That's going to be hype to see. So, one time, what the fuck Kyoriku is doing? Of course, tell me your thoughts in the comment section down below, guys. Here's come from last week. What do you guys think about Kyoriku staying in the Squad 1 barracks? What the fuck has he been doing? And do you think he should sort out the fucking Zerotapers before worrying about Squad 0? Do you think if Kyoriku is making an appearance, do you think Ukitake is going to start making an appearance? Because that would be fucking awesome. How long do you think until Ichigo starts getting up to Squad Zero and starts helping them out? Because they left a while ago and we need to start seeing some hardcore number one action, if you know what I mean. Really enjoyable chapter. Really enjoyed it. Of course, you guys have been Hansened. I'll just catch you motherfuckers next week. Peace out, motherfuckers.